Welcome to Nambour Anglican Parish. This is our online service. We pray that this service will encourage you and help you in your relationship with God and your understanding of the Christian faith. If you want more information about the Christian faith or our church, please see our church website for more details. We hope that this service will help you, as all of us going through a difficult time at the moment. Let me pray. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for all your goodness to us. We pray that you'll help us to see life through your eyes and to bring all our needs to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Praise and thanksgiving to God. Make a joyful noise to God, all the earth. Sing the glory of his name. Give to God glorious praise. Say, how awesome are your deeds. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honour and glory and praise. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom, and as you sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs with gratitude in your hearts to God. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Gracious God, we humbly thank you for life and health and safety, for freedom to work, leisure to rest, and for all that is beautiful in creation and human life. But above all, we praise you for our Saviour, Jesus Christ, for his death and resurrection, for the gift of your Spirit, and for the hope of sharing in your glory. Fill our hearts with all joy and peace in believing, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Peace. We are the body of Christ.
His spirit is with us.
The peace of the Lord be always with you
and also with you.
Members of our parish are invited to give their support by online giving. You see the link on our website. Prayer over our gifts. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have these gifts to share. Accept and use our offerings for your glory and for the service of your kingdom.
Blessed be God forever.
And now we come to the ministry of the word. Thank you, Father, for making yourself known to us and showing the way of salvation through faith in your Son. We ask you now to teach and encourage us through your word, so that we may be ready to serve you for the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
A reading from Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 5, verses 1 to 11. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. and we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance, character, and character, hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. You see, at just the same time, the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? For if while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his Son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? Not only is this so, but we also boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew, chapter 9, verses 35-10:8. Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them, because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his field." Jesus called his 12 disciples to him and gave them authority to drive out impure spirits and to heal every disease and sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, who is called Peter, and his brother Andrew, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector, James, son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus, son of Simon the Zealot, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions: "Do not go among the Gentiles or enter any town of the Samaritans. Go rather to the lost sheep of Israel. As you go, proclaim the message: the kingdom of heaven has come near. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those who have leprosy, drive out demons. Freely you have received, freely give." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Let us affirm our faith together.
We believe in one God, who made and loves all that is. We believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was born, lived, died, and rose again, and is coming to call all to account. We believe in the Holy Spirit, who calls, equips, and sends out God's people and brings all things to their true end. This is our faith, the faith of the Church. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
In this Trinity season we're in, when we think about what it means to know and love and serve the one God in three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we're considering prayer. And it's very apt that we think about prayer at this time, because prayer is a most Trinitarian action of the Christian. We pray to the Father, through the Son, by the Spirit. So I'm thinking with you about the Trinitarian nature of prayer. There are therefore these three main conditions for Christian prayer. It needs to be to the Father according to God's will. We looked at that the other week. And we need to pray through Jesus in his name. And we need to pray in the Spirit or by the Spirit. I'll look at that next week. So today I'd like to talk to you and explore with you this fascinating and important subject of what it means to pray in the name of Jesus, or, as St. Paul often says, through Jesus. Jesus himself in John's Gospel chapter 14 said to the disciples, "You may ask me for anything in my name and I will do it." In my name. It's a strange thing, I was reflecting on this, how often in my Christian life I've learned from other people to pray in the name of Jesus, Amen. Or we ask, "Dear Lord, we ask you this through Jesus, Amen." And yet I don't think I've really stopped a lot to think about what I mean when I'm saying that in my prayers. What does it mean? What do the scriptures mean by praying in the name of Jesus? So I'd like to explore that with you today. It's a theological aspect, but it will make a difference, I believe, I hope, for our praying. First of all, I want to clear away some wrong ideas about what praying in the name of Jesus might be. I want to say, first of all, this is not a magical thing. It's not a magical invocation of the name of Jesus. Christian prayer presumes genuine faith in Jesus. It's not a magical exercise. It's not saying, "Say the right words, abracadabra, in the name of Jesus, and the prayer will be effective." It's not like that. We have a dramatic example of this in the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 19, in the early days of the church. Luke tells us some Jews went around driving out evil spirits, and they tried to invoke the name of Jesus over those who were demon-possessed. They would say, "In the name of Jesus, the Jesus whom Paul preaches, I command you to come out." In other words, you see, they'd seen and heard Paul delivering people and praying in the name of Jesus. And they thought, "We'll try this out too." And Luke goes on, "Seven sons of Sceva, a Jewish chief priest, were doing this. One day the evil spirit answered them, 'Jesus I know and Paul I know about, but who are you?' Then the man who had the evil spirit jumped on them and overpowered them. He gave them such a beating that they ran out of the house naked and bleeding." It's a dramatic incident. In other words, they tried to use the name of Jesus in a magical way, thinking they would therefore have power, spiritual power, in their invocation and prayer. But it didn't work. It backfired in a dramatic way. The name of Jesus is not some magical abracadabra word we mention. It presumes relationship with God and with Jesus himself. And the second comment I want to make is that Christian prayer in the name of Jesus is not a mechanical thing. It's not a matter of saying the right words. In the name of Jesus, you must say that or the prayer won't work. You must say it in the right way. You use the right words. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 6 in the Sermon on the Mount about prayer, "When you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for when they think they will be heard because of their many words, do not be like them." In other words, it's not a matter about the actual words you use, the form of prayer, or the numbers of words, or the length of your prayer and praying at long time and anything like that. It's not a mechanical exercise, as prayer has often been in the world, not a mechanical exercise. So we can put those two wrong ideas out of our mind, and let's ask ourselves what therefore prayer might be. But first, there is another wrong idea. Praying in the name of Jesus is not a way we have of getting God the Father on our side. Some people think that we have an unwilling God the Father who needs to be brought over to our side by the intercession of Jesus. So we need Jesus to get God on our side. That God is angry or uninterested or reluctant or just needs to be persuaded by Jesus. And this, of course, makes no sense of the gospel. It's such a wrong view of God. There's no Trinitarian sense in saying that we need a sympathetic Jesus against an uncaring or a reluctant father. It's God who loves the world so much that he sent his son, as John 3:16 tells us. So we can't play Jesus and God off against one another, Jesus and God the Father, because he and the Father are one. And God has only good intentions for us. Jesus, God is our Father. He doesn't want to give us a stone when we ask for bread. So we mustn't think that praying in the name of Jesus is a way of getting a reluctant father onto our side. So let's look then at what praying in the name of Jesus means. I believe it's got three aspects to it. If you like, think of it as a rope with three strands that tie together to make Christian prayer in the name of Jesus. First of all, we pray in the name of Jesus when we appeal to him as the Lord of the earth, the Lord who has authority and power on earth to rule and therefore to answer our prayers. The second aspect of it, the scriptures teach, we pray in the name of Jesus and through Jesus when we come to God in union with Christ, who is our great true intercessor, the one who is with the Father for us in the presence of the throne room of God. And the third strand in this rope, we pray in the name of Jesus when our prayers express our abiding communion with Christ. When we pray according to his will, in his name, in fellowship with him. Let's look at those three things today. We pray in the name of Jesus when we appeal to him as the Lord. The name of Jesus is the authority of Jesus. In biblical thinking, the name of someone is their character, their status, their dignity, their authority. Now, we know from the Psalms that the Lord has put human beings in charge of the earth. The psalmist says in Psalm 115, "The highest heavens belong to the Lord, but to the earth he has given to mankind." Humankind has been put in charge of the earth. But, of course, we do not see human beings able to do what God wants on earth, able to rule. But we see Jesus, says the letter to the Hebrews, as the true divine son and the true human king on earth, able to rule. Hebrews 2 verses 5 to 9 is crucial. In putting, we don't see, he says, the Psalm 8 realized on earth. We don't see human beings properly ruling the earth. But he says, verse 9, we do see Jesus, who was made lower than the angels for a little while, now crowned with glory and honor because he suffered death, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone. We see a new man, the true Lord of the earth, the true image of God, the divine creator himself, the Son of God, ruling over the world. That's what it means when we call Jesus Lord. We pray in the name of Jesus the Lord. And of course, as the Lord, Jesus is indeed the divine agent of creation. All things were made through him and for him. He is the true king of the world. So we pray in the name of Jesus as the real governor of the earth, the one who exercises authority on earth now. Remember the risen Jesus in Galilee, as he farewelled the disciples in that great commission, said, "All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations." All authority, spiritual authority in heaven on earth has been given to Jesus. Jesus, therefore, we might say, has legal authority on earth to exercise divine and human rule. In our society, we know what it is. We have government and individuals, private individuals, do not have authority to do certain things, only officially recognized agents of the government have authority to exercise certain regulations and laws. Jesus has the spiritual and legal authority to rule on earth. He also has the power that goes with it. He's the victorious ruler of earth. We know that he has defeated usurping evil powers that long ago have been blocking and impeding the rule of God on earth, impeding God's rule and subverting the well-being of human beings. Right at the opening of the book of the Revelation to John, we read this in chapter 1, verse 5. "To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood and has made us to be a kingdom and priests to serve his God and Father, To him be glory and power forever and ever. That's our Lord, the ruler of the kings of the earth, it's read. Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings of earth. And a little further on in chapter 5, in this great scene of worship in the heavenly place, we see how Jesus is lauded by the angels. You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, because you were slain, and with your blood you purchased for God persons from every tribe and language and people and nation. And it goes on and says, worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise. Jesus has power to defeat Satan. Power of the blood of Jesus. Power of the name of Jesus. I don't know whether you've experienced, but I have experienced it in my ministry. The power of the invocation by faith of the name of Jesus over the operation of the evil one. Very real. So when we pray in the name of Jesus, we are praying on the basis that the real power in prayer is Christ's, that the real authority on earth is Jesus, and that he's the one on whom we rely as we exercise our ministry of prayer. Now remember, the psalm said that human beings were put on earth to rule the earth, but we can't rule the earth, but we can exercise power and authority on earth, not our own, but the Lord's. We can ask the Lord to exercise his human, the divine rule on earth, and in work it, exercise it through our prayer. So we should see prayer in the name of Jesus as asking the Lord to exercise his rule on earth for the benefit of people, for the extension of the kingdom. The second facet in this strand of prayer, the second strand of praying in the name of Jesus, is when we come to God in union with the Jesus who is the true intercessor. You know, when we pray in the name of Jesus, the real prayer is Jesus. The one who's really praying is Jesus. Our prayers are offered with his prayers and in him. He is our priest in the presence of the throne room of heaven. He is the real intercessor, and he prays perfectly for the prayers of humanity before the throne of God. You and I might feel inadequate in our prayer life. I certainly have, constantly feeling like I really don't know how to pray and I'm very weak in prayer. But Jesus, when we pray in the name of Jesus, our weak prayers are joined with his powerful praying. The letter to the Hebrews evokes this. Chapter 4, verse 14. Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has ascended into heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way just as we are, yet he did not sin. Let us approach God's throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Jesus is the great priest on our behalf, representing us, channeling our prayers with his prayers to the Father. He is our great intercessor. And a number of times the New Testament picks this up, talking about the intercession of Jesus, Hebrews 7, verse 25. Therefore, he is able to save completely those who come to God through him, because he always lives to intercede for them. St. Paul picks it up too in Romans chapter 8, verse 34, speaking of prayer, the ministry of prayer, and the intercession of Jesus. Who will separate us from the love of God? And who can condemn us? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. So when we pray through Jesus in his name, we recognize that our supplications are not based on our own merits, but are clothed with the merits of Jesus Christ, the obedient Son of God. He's there in heaven for us. We're right there with him. He's representing us and we are in him. He is our intercessor in heaven, offering his life for us, offering all his work for us. We are represented in him, and all his work for us and in us is the basis of our prayers. And what he is praying for, what is he praying for us? It's a stimulating idea to think that Jesus is praying for us. He is helping us actively. He is identified with us and we with him. All his work for us and in us is the basis of our prayers. He's offering us grace and mercy to help in time of need, says Hebrews. He's offering us health and help and strength. Now, the word intercession here in those few significant references means more than praying. He is, whatever he's doing for us in his intercession is what we need. He is doing for us what we need. And as we come to God through him, asking for help, he will give us help, what we need. Very important. Here's an old commentator writing on the subject. We are to understand of it, that is this intercession of Christ, of every act by which the Son, in dependence of the Father, in the Father's name and with the perfect concurrence of the Father, takes his own with him into the Father's presence, in order that whatever he himself enjoys in the communications of his Father's love may also become theirs. He takes his own with him into the Father's presence, and whatever he enjoys in the blessing in the presence of God the Father, we also enjoy. Whatever he does for us, we benefit from. So when we think our prayers are weak, we need to remember they're not weak, because they are empowered and conveyed, our true needs, by the intercession of the Son. I wish I could understand this better and explain it better. I wish I could understand it better. But it's a wonderful idea, because so often we feel weak in prayer, but when we pray in Jesus' name, we need to see ourselves there with him. Our prayers really going into his heart, our needs coming before the Lord, our high priest, and being empowered. It's almost as if we have this weak little electrical signal of prayer. But when it comes in Jesus' name to him in the presence of the throne of grace, it is boosted by the power of the high priest. When we pray to God through Jesus Christ, we should remember we are sharing in the blessings and communion of the Son in the throne room of God, and his life flows to us. Now, the third aspect of this is how we pray in the name of Jesus when our prayers express our abiding communion with the Lord. I take you back to the great discourse in John 14, 15 and 16 of John's Gospel. Jesus says in John 15, I am the vine, the true vine, and you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. He says, if you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. This is to my Father's glory that you bear much fruit, showing yourself to be my disciples. As we abide close to Christ, as we live, if you like, in our heavenly union with him on earth, obeying his commands, having fellowship with him, dwelling in him, we will find that our praying expresses this communion and will be fruitful. So the living presence of Jesus with us is vital for our praying. Jesus promised that his disciples would be helped by the coming of the Helper, the Holy Spirit, we've been remembering on Pentecost Sunday. And that Holy Spirit will help us to pray. John chapter 16, verses 12 to 15. When he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all the truth. He will glorify me, because it is from me that he will receive what he will make known to you. He will make known what Jesus wants us to know. And a little further on in verse 23, in that day you will no longer ask me anything. Very truly I tell you, my Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. Until now you have not asked for anything in my name. Ask and you will receive, and your joy will be complete. Here Jesus in the upper room explains how the Holy Spirit will inspire our praying. And at this point, I want to flag that in the next sermon, I'll be talking about that particular third condition of prayer, that we need to pray by the Spirit and in the Holy Spirit. But it's much the same idea that I'm talking to you now about. We pray close to Jesus, and Jesus' prayers become our prayers. We'll pray in the name of Jesus when we see our praying as part of our communion in the Lord Jesus Christ, as we spend time with the Lord, walking closely with him, allowing his life to indwell us, more and more our prayers will express his prayers. If you ask anything in my name, he said, I will do it. So what difference then, in conclusion, can I say today? What difference will it make in our praying if we pray in the name of Jesus properly? If we pray through Jesus, as Paul puts it? Well, first, we should be able to come to God with much more confidence, because our praying is simply part of the greater and more powerful praying of the Lord. And he is the Lord of heaven and earth. He has authority and power to answer our prayers. Our prayers should be more in line with Jesus' prayers. Our prayers on earth will become more and more the intercession of Jesus in the unseen presence of the Father in the throne room of heaven. In fact, when we pray, I find this helpful, to think, I'm now kneeling down with Jesus in the throne room of heaven. May my prayers express the fellowship of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. May we see the purpose of God achieved in our prayers. And thirdly, we will see our prayers and our relationship with Jesus closely intertwined. If we want to see our prayer life enriched, then our spiritual life and our fellowship with Jesus needs to stay close. We need to wait on Jesus, obey him, enjoy him, have fellowship with him. I hope and pray that these thoughts today will stimulate you as much as they've stimulated me to enrich my praying, enrich our praying, to pray truly in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Let us approach the throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Let us now confess our sins to Almighty God.
Heavenly Father, you have loved us with an everlasting love, but we have broken your holy laws and have left undone what we ought to have done. We are sorry for our sins and turn away from them. For the sake of your Son who died for us, forgive us, cleanse us and change us. By your Holy Spirit, enable us to live for you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
From the letter to the Romans, chapter 6, verses 10 to 11. Christ died to sin once for all, but the life he lives to God. In the same way, count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Jesus Christ. God desires that none should perish, but that all should turn to Christ and live. In response to his call, we acknowledge our sins. God pardons those who humbly repent and truly believe the gospel. Therefore, we have peace with God through Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us join together in saying the Lord's Prayer.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, your Son Jesus Christ has promised that you will hear us when we ask in faith. Receive the prayers we offer. We pray for your church in other countries, your church in Australia, and our own diocese. We pray for all our clergy, that they may be guided by you in this critical time. We pray for Philip, our Archbishop, Jeremy, our Regional Bishop, and Ralph, our priest in charge. We also pray for all those who assist in the ministry of your word. We ask for your blessing on all world leaders and those who make and administer our laws. We pray for our governments, both state and federal, as they work together in these difficult times. Help them to work together in friendship and concern for each other and for the betterment and safety of our nation. Father, we pray for one another, those in our local community, and people known to us who need your support at this time. Father, we beseech you to shine your light in the darkness of these times so that people do not become consumed with fear and doubt. Help us to encourage others to turn to you and come to realize your promise that all things work together for good for those who love you. We pray for those who are suffering, the sick, the distressed, the lonely, the outcast, the persecuted, and those who mourn and those who care for them. Loving God, we pray that you will comfort and heal all who are ill, all who are lonely and depressed, those who feel unloved, and those who are suffering because they have no love of you, for you. We praise you, Lord God, for your faithful servants in every age, and we pray that we, with all who have died in the faith of Christ, may be brought to a joyful resurrection and the fulfillment of your eternal kingdom. Almighty God, you have promised to hear our prayers. Grant that what we have asked in faith we may by your grace receive. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Loving God, we thank you for hearing our prayers, feeding us with your word, and encouraging us in our meeting together.
Take us and use us to love and serve you and all people in the power of your Spirit and in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Now, friends, if you haven't already done so, I invite you perhaps to for just take a minute and to get some wine or juice and some bread, perhaps, something simple. And we'll do together an act of spiritual communion in thanksgiving. So we invite you to join in a simple act of eating some bread or drinking some wine or juice as we give thanks for the salvation Christ has won for us in his death and resurrection. We'll just wait for a minute or so for you to get those things together if you haven't got them ready, and then we'll move forward with this spiritual communion.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Loving God, in union with Christians throughout the world, we offer you praise and thanksgiving today. Even though we are unable to eat and drink the Lord's Supper together, we rejoice in our union with Christ and his body through the Spirit and rest in his saving gift of life. Amen. Friends, Christian people around the world at the moment are not able often to take communion together. So we invite you to have your own communion with us at home in an act of spiritual reception. So if you've got some bread and some juice or wine, something to drink and something to eat, we'll remember the Lord's Supper together. Hear what St. Paul said to the church about this. He received, he says, from the Lord what he also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given you thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Let us pray then for this act of spiritual communion. Loving God, in union with Christian people throughout the world and across the centuries, we listen to your holy word and receive the precious body and blood of your dear Son in the bread and the wine. We offer you praise and thanksgiving. And even though we are exiled from tasting the bread of heaven and drinking the cup of life, we pray that you will unite us with all the baptized people of God and with your Son who gave his life for us. Amen. Let us eat and drink together. Amen. May the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you what is pleasing in his sight. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace, filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. In the name of Christ. Amen. I will.